few months. So I'm looking forward to that.
And how old will you be, Mr. Lumpkin?
Well, if my mathematics is correct, or arithmetic, whatever you want to say, I'll be 97 years old. Woo! Age of you guys. And looking around, you look pretty interesting and real like you have a bright future. I wish I'd like to be in your shoes. It seems to me that the world is there for your asking, and your future is in front of you, and mine is getting near the end. So the thing that I'd like to encourage you to do is to do the best that you can in terms of the opportunities that are available to you, and that you each day do that. Because it's going to add up. You may not think it's very important at this point in time, but you're going to have challenges in your life, and what you are trying to do is to prepare yourself to meet those challenges when they occur. And they are going to occur, not each and every day, but frequently. And hopefully what you're doing, studying in terms of, I would say in STEM, are these the STEM students?
Yes, they are.
Yeah, so you're the cream of the crop, which basically means that your chances of success are very good if you will apply yourself and do the best that you can, as I say. I keep stressing that because you don't think that it is important, but it really is. Each and every day, if you do your best, then you don't have to worry about regretting. You don't have to worry about, I could have done this or I could have done that, because you can't go back. You cannot go back. Cannot go back to yesterday. Yesterday is there, it's already gone, and whatever you have done is then going to be added on to the future. Let me see. I was in Italy during World War II. World War II was from the 1939, and went on until the Japanese they gave up, and I think it was September 2, 1945. That was a war that this whole country participated in, and it was very unusual because the United States has been in several wars, but that was the only one that during my lifetime, that there was not much controversy. Everybody was interested in doing the best that they could to try and defeat. At that time, it was the Germans and the Japanese and Italy. They were called the Axis. And they were quite powerful. Hitler, do you all know who Hitler is?
Yes.
And he's probably the most famous of the three leaders at the time, Giorgio and the Japanese, and Mussolini, the Italians, and Hitler from the Germans. And during the time that where it really got started as far as the United States is concerned was in Pearl Harbor. Pearl Harbor occurred on December the 7th, 1941, and that is one day that I will never forget because I was in bed at the time and could hardly believe that the Japanese had struck Pearl Harbor. And the news at that time was not like it is today, where you see something and then you just see it over and over and over and over, and to the point where you can actually study it to see what you missed the first time that you saw it. It is something that happened, and it's the thing that really helped this country come together as a unit to be against Germany and being willing to join the war against the Axis. And shortly thereafter, President Roosevelt went to Congress and the country declared war. At that time, I was A1. Do any of you know what an A1 is? Well, in those days, every male, 18 years, when you reached your 18th birthday, 18th year of life, you had to register for the draft. And you were given a physical examination, and if you passed that examination, you were then classified as 1A. Which meant that you were then eligible to be drafted into the military. What you do then is you just wait until it's your time to be called. And eventually it did come, and for me it came on July the 1st, 1942. And from then on, you know where Fort MacArthur is? Any of you? San Pedro in Los Angeles here. That was the induction station for this area, and everybody had to go down there and be inducted into the service. That's what happened to me. You're sitting in a room which is much larger than this, but all the recruits come in and they give you a battery of examinations in which you take them. Then they score them, and this takes a couple of days, 3 days, I guess. And then when you get through, what they do is to then give you orders to go to different places in the country to get your basic training. And I was sent to Tuskegee, Alabama. At that time, I did not know much about Tuskegee. And what it was a base where they were sending Negroes, that's what we were called at that time, Black soldiers to be in the Army Air Corps at that time. It was called the Army Air Corps. And so that's where I was sent. When my orders came out, I thought that I was going to be in the Signal Corps, but by the time I got to Tuskegee, we were sent there on a train. There were about three of us. We were sent there in a compartment on the train. And a compartment on the train is a very nice arrangement, very comfortable to sent there, we really thought we were big shots to be in a compartment. But when we got to Texas, we found out why we were on that train. I mean, why we were in that compartment. It was because we were black, and we were crossing the Mason-Dixon line. And the Mason-Dixon line is the point in the United States where the segregation was at its highest, and you're not allowed from that point on to have a free run of the train. We had to have our meals in the compartment, and that was the way that it was. So we didn't like that, but that's the way things were at that time. Went through the to Tuskegee, and at the railroad station, etc. And then again, we have the same kind of things to do, is to go through your basic training. I went through that, and then to Officer Kennedy School, and then to Selfridge Field. That's another Air Force base where they train everybody for combat. There to going across the ocean on Liberty Ship. Liberty Ship is a ship that's about as long as this room is. And it's about as wide as this room also. And we had three squadrons. The 100 Fighter Squadron, 301st and the 302nd Fighter Squadron. And what we did was to each squadron was in one of those ships. Now I don't know how many of you have been on the ocean, but in a ship that size, it's very uncomfortable. And a lot of us, including me, got seasick. Not only that, the Germans had their U-boats, their submarines, which were really very effective at that time. And what they were doing, we were going across the ocean in a convoy. You know what a convoy is? A convoy.
Very popular.
What they do is to put these ships all together, and they're convoyed across the ocean with the warships around them in order to protect them. And we had two real serious kind of incidents. One is the weather storm, just like this. Hurricane is coming through, looks like it's going to get into the United States pretty soon. It's really, I forget what the name of it is, the current hurricane. But anyway, it's a it's something that you don't want to experience as far as that's concerned.
I'm going to ask you a question.
Good.
Put a pin in that right there. The video is now up.
Okay.
So we'll take a look at this.